You know, somebody told me years ago that confession is good for the soul, but bad for the reputation. So I'm going to publicly confess to Brother Randy. Along about Thursday, he started asking me for my notes. And I so on Friday, I sent him 9 pictures for show and tell. And we have a few challenges today, and that just means, I was telling Aaron, I said, that just means I'm going to have to come up with 9,000 extra words because we don't have those pictures. And so that just means I'm going to try to get finished before the worship service tonight at 6, okay? Well, thank you very much for giving us a shot and letting us be part of this series. You know, I was pondering this journey, and, you know, and Pastor Randy had called it, in my story, there's victory. You know, and as I was pondering this part of the journey and story that I'm going to share with you today, I just kind of got overwhelmed that it's not my story. It's really God's story that we get to be a part of. And, you know, so just a little tweak there in terms of that part of the process there. I did bring some show and tell just in case, you know, for that. So we'll see how that works out. First Peter 3:15 says, "But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you." And I would submit to you that this story thing, this testimony thing, this journey thing is part of the intent of why God allows these things to happen, is to give us hope. And we know why. Because we've seen Him be faithful. Now, Carl and I went to a reunion for this organization we used to be in, and let's just say everybody had a little more belly and a little grayer hair, and you know. But it was interesting that one of the things that stood out to a majority of the people there, after you've been around for a while, is God's faithful. He does what He says He's going to do. And it's a great blessing to hang around long enough to be able to experience that. And when He does that, it gives us hope. Part of our job is to begin to identify those and be ready always to give an answer. Why? Because there's people out there that have no hope. And one of our jobs as a witness is to tell them why we have hope. If you watch the news, you don't get a lot of hope there. You know, another verse along this journey that's been meaningful to me in John 16:33. And it says, I'm going to have to put my glasses on because my arms are no longer long enough. John 16:33, Jesus says this, "These things I have spoken unto you, that you might have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world." So, if you hadn't figured it out yet, as long as we're here on planet Earth, in this dirt suit or earth suit, we will have tribulation. I think that's a part where the enemy's lied to us. That if things are the way God wants them to be, that I don't have tribulation and temptation and oppression. No. He said, you're going to have those. So when we get sometimes along the journey, till we understand that, we get surprised by it. And we go, wait a minute, get thee behind me, Satan, that ain't God. Well, maybe. So But the good news is in the midst of that tribulation, he says, I've overcome it. And that's the part of the journey that we're always looking for, is in the midst of the tribulation that he promised we would have, his overcoming. Of course, Romans 8:28, we all know it and love it and quote it all the time, you know, and we know that all things work together for good to those that love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. And it's interesting to me, as I've quoted and memorized and quoted and meditated and quoted that verse, it says that we can know it, that all things work together for good. It doesn't say that all things are good. It really chaps me a bit when you hear people give that little cliche. It's all good. Well, it's not. That ain't the promise. The promise is, I'm going to use that for good. So we begin to, if we want things to be all good, and if you think that all things are good, I got some swamp land I want to talk to you about. That ain't true. But God says, I'm going to use whatever that tribulation was for good. And if we get to stay around long enough, we begin to see that. Well, I'm going to take you back to 20-something years ago. On May 12th, 2002, is where the beginning of this journey, of this story that I want to talk to you about. May 12th, 2002 was Mother's Day. My oldest son, John, worked the parking lot at Bethany. We went to eat at a Chinese restaurant after lunch. And this weird thing happened at the Chinese restaurant. John didn't eat anything. John was a strapping 15-year-old boy that feed them and they will come. And he did. So for him to not have an appetite and not eat was unusual. We get home that day. Now, just to give you a little heads up here, my wife Carla is the vice president in charge of details in our family, and I never met a detail that I really liked. So if you hear in this area over here, I missed something a little bit in there, but I'm going to ask for grace. So John came home and went to bed, and he had bruises on him, and we were like going, well, he's got three brothers, then they fight all the time. What's the big deal? And he's got 105 fever, and we were going, what's that about? So we went through the day, and I don't remember if it was Sunday or Monday, but somewhere in that process, I'm in the shower about 10 o'clock at night, and this still small voice says, draw his blood and run a CBC. Well, I'm a medical technologist by training. I put in laboratories for doctors. I had access to labs, and I had access to needles and tubes. So I went to my drawer, I pulled them out, and I went in there and I drew John's blood. And I went over to one of my labs, and I'm over there at, 10:30, 11, and I run a CBC on son John, going 105 fever. I'm thinking infection. Well, I get the results, and they weren't good. I'm like, what in the world? I ran it again. Same thing. I called, Carla gave me the pediatrician's number, and I called her and told her, and she didn't believe the results and said, we'll just get it rechecked in the morning. Well, this is what I do. And so I'm going to give you some numbers just to kind of give you some context. The white blood count that John had, the normal range is 4.5 to 10.9, and his was 0.9. Hemoglobin, the normal range is 12 to 18, and his was 5.6. The hematocrit normal range was 37 to 51, and his was a 16. And his platelets are 150 to 450, and his were 5. Not good. The doctor says, she's going, no way, you know, we'll run it again in the morning. Well, I knew it was what it was. I got home, and Carla and I were talking, and we're not waiting until the morning to figure that, you know, to go into there. So we put John in the car, and we went to Our Lady of the Lake ER, and they took us back in a room and told us what I told him what I'd gotten, and the guy says, well, we'll rerun it and see. And the nurse came back and said, that's what it is. That's right. I said, well, I knew that. Well, I don't know, maybe in the middle of the night, 4 o'clock, 3 o'clock or something like that, I called my pastor, Bethany, and probably about 5 o'clock, you know, people from church started showing up, walking down the hall. And and we were glad to see them. They finally put John in a room at 5 or 6 in the morning. And then people from church started showing up down the hall. And somewhere in that part of the day, that pediatrician showed up, and she had gone by the lab to see what it looked like before she came to see me. And when she came down the hall, she came to me and she had tears in her eyes and said, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. You did the right thing, Dad. Already knew that. Well, it's interesting. When these people from church, I had the people in the cell group sitting there, and we were in a circle, and it, you know, as Charlie and I like to say, let's pray. Has it come to that? It had come to that. So here we got these guys there in the hall outside John's room in Our Lady of the Lake, and we started to pray. And, you know, sometimes when you get a bunch of people together to pray, you can kind of run off in the ditch if you're not careful, you know what I mean? But it was interesting when it got around to me to pray. It was like this: the Spirit of God just rose up and he said, give thanks. What the? You know, I had memorized 1 Thessalonians 5:18, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God for you in Christ Jesus. So, with a little shakiness in my voice, I said, Lord, thank you. Thank you. Thank you that we're here. Thank you that it's not looking good. Thank you that we're at death's door. Thank you. It just didn't sneak up on you. Well, I didn't realize it at that point, but that was a major victory in the midst of this story. When God nailed that truth down, that whatever you're going through, all give thanks. It doesn't say be thankful. It says give thanks. And I would submit to you that giving thanks is an expression of faith. That God is in control, he's on the throne, he's good, and nothing snuck up on him. He already knew that. I needed to know that. But as I look back on that, something opened in terms of my heart to accept that, or a faith to rise up that I knew. And it was by learning, by obeying, giving thanks in all things. So I don't care how bad the deal is that you're going through, give thanks. Because that is good for you, not just for the Lord there. Carla goes home. mother's heart. She wants her son to be comfortable. Well, while Carlo was at home getting his nunu and his little blankie and all that kind of stuff so he'd be comfortable, the pediatric oncologist shows up, and I'm there. And she walks in, and she looks at John, and she looks at me, and she just says, bedside manner, you ready? Dad, your son has leukemia. Boom! Like, okay. Well, it wasn't long after that that Carla showed back up with all John's stuff, and let's just say that the pediatric oncologist, no bedside manner, did exactly the same thing to Carla when she was coming back trying to make him feel comfortable. And she just goes, Mom, your son has leukemia. We don't have time to get emotional. We just need to start jumping on it. We were like going, what the heck is going on here? She says, Dad, where do you want to, you know, there are lots of places you can send your son for this. Where do you want to go? And I'm going, like, I've researched the pediatric oncology centers in America and evaluated all of them, and I choose this one. I don't know, Doc, where would you recommend? And she said, St. Jude. Well, we made a decision then to go to St. Jude. But what we found out was that not only did he have leukemia, but he had a systemic staph infection. And that's where that 105 fever was coming from. So what we found out was that condition he had of leukemia that wiped all of his bone marrow out is what we call pancytopenia. So not only did he not have any white cells, he was low on red cells, he was low on hemoglobin, and he had no platelets. So he could bleed. So they had to treat him with antibiotics and platelets and factor for 2 days just to get him to the point that we could fly up to St. Jude at 6 o'clock in the morning. John and I, he's leaning against the wall on the Northwest flight straight to Memphis. They have a van to pick us up at St. Jude. They take us over to the front of St. Jude, and they dumped us out. So I'm sitting there at 7 o'clock in the morning in front of St. Jude, and I'm looking for, because John was a big kid, I'm looking for a full-size wheelchair. There were lots of these little miniature kitty ones all around the place, but one that John could sit in, I had to go look all over that place. So, I had to lean John up against a row, a no parking sign. So he's leaning against this no parking sign in the front of St. Jude, balancing while I go find a wheelchair. Finally found one, we wheel him in. The doctor goes, he's really sick. And so they run him in to do a diagnostic, you know, there. So he goes in. They said, we need to do a bone marrow. So we do a bone marrow. And the nurse in that process at St. Jude, very astute, said, we need to get this kid up to ICU. So they bypassed the regular stuff, sent us to ICU, and we're in a step-down room right off of ICU at St. Jude. And about 4 o'clock that afternoon, the doctors came in and says, we've read the bone marrow. His diagnosis is acute promyelocytic leukemia. Okay. And they said this, if he survives the first part, it's treatable. Oh, that sounds good. But we want to get started on the chemo right now. So they did that afternoon. Carla was coming up. This was a Wednesday. Carla was coming up on Friday. I was in the room. They have professional baby monitors in the St. Jude room, so you hear, feel everything in there. Well, that night, John began to have a difficulty breathing. And so, like, at 3 o'clock in the morning, I'm in there at his bedside. We've got a doctor in there. And he says, John's lungs are filling up with blood. And John looked up at me and he goes, Dad, I feel like crap. Well, as a parent, every time your kid has one of those labored breathings, you feel it too. And if you've ever had a kid near anything like that, the first thing you want to do is trade places with them. I'll get in that bed. I'll take your place. Wasn't an option. So that began a part of the process when they started it. We found out later on that there were only like 6 or 7 cases of that APL at St. Jude. And I called Carla that day and said, yeah, better come on up. Because I thought this is probably going to be it. Well, the good news is that next day they moved us into room 5. So I was encouraged. Well, me, room 5. Well, 5 is the number of grace. I'm looking for something that says, God, are you here? And room 5, grace. Well, that first night in room 6, they roll a kid out of that room on a stretcher with a sheet over his body. Out of room 6. The kid was from Baton Rouge. I went, oh my God, it's real bullets here. Well, I went back in John's room in room 5. And I got my oil and I got Psalm 91. And I said, 1,000 may all at my right left side and 10,000 at my right side, but it's not coming. I'm going to do a little King James. Not coming nigh thee. It ain't coming in here. So I didn't know anything else to do. I just went down every wall with the oil, and I went down every wall, and I went through that whole room saying, it ain't coming in here. Because right through that wall right there, somebody had just died. It's not coming in here. It was interesting, you know, when I was applying Psalm 91, you know, at Bethany, Brother Larry, you know, he said, call me anytime you need me. I went, oh, wow, yes. So I called him and I said, hey, what's the deal? Kid just died. They were Christian parents. What's the deal? And he said, Andy, I don't understand all this healing stuff. I just know that I'm going to give account of myself. So don't try to figure out what they're doing or not doing. And don't try to figure out what they're doing or not doing. He said, you do what you need to do. I said, okay. Somewhere in the journey, I gained a sort of notoriety with the St. Jude staff as the father who diagnosed his son's leukemia. They would come in and look at me like I was a weird or something like that, you know. So I said, okay, here, we're going to have a little deal here. Every morning I want you to come in with your most recent lab results because I can read them and I know what, and I ask questions and I know what to do with them. And then I found myself, when the doc would come in and they would bring those results, I found myself going, Doc, what do you need to happen today? What do you want to happen today for John? And he'd give me a list of things. And then all of a sudden, and this was back for internet stuff, and net zero was the email, and all I did was just send out an email to friends of what we needed that day. Oxygen sats to go up. One of them even had, it says, we need a bowel movement, you know, and as part of that journey. So I said, Doc, here's the deal. You do what you do, and I'm going to do what I do. You take care of the medical, I'm going to take care of the spiritual. but I need to know what you need to happen, because I'm going to make sure that it happens in my world. It seemed like in that part of the journey that every day there was some other problem that came up. You know, we start out with leukemia, then we have a systemic staph infection, then we've got bleeding issues, his lungs fill up with blood, and then they made the decision in there to put him on a ventilator. And to have him on a ventilator meant that they had to put him in a drug-induced coma. This is where I have a picture. Try one up there, and if it works, hey, just turn around and look at that back screen. Next picture. Next picture. Kind of gives you some idea there. I apologize, it's not 60 feet tall behind me. You know, but kind of gives you a picture there of what it looked like in there. So you have your 15-year-old kid with these things going down, breathing for him, and he's knocked out. Well, Carla got up there, and a couple of things happened there that were significant in terms of that part of the process. She got up there, and you want to tell this part? Well, all of you know my friend Charlie, and Charlie tells it this way. When I heard about y'all and John being sick, I got up, I went in the bathroom, I got my Bible out, and I said, I need a word for Andy and Carl and John. And the Lord speaks to him and says, it's not a sickness unto death. And he goes, shh, I'm trying to get a word for Andy and Carl and John. And the Lord said, did you just shush me? I guess I did. And he said, and I've given you the word. So Charlie came with that word. This is not a sickness unto death. Well, Carla got it as a rhema word when he said it, and it went deep into her heart, and her faith rose as a result of that. When I heard it, my response was, that is the perfect will of God, but there's some part of this journey that I need to participate in. And so Carla, with that word, she went and got, can I have picture number four? So if you look back there, you see all those poster boards up there on the wall? Look up here now. Those are the poster boards of the word that Carla wrote up and stuck on that wall. So that this is what the Lord says. Do not be afraid or discouraged because of this vast army. For the battle is not yours, but God's. You will not have to fight this battle. Take up your positions, stand firm, and see the deliverance the Lord will give you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Go out and face Him tomorrow, and the Lord will be with you. That's what was on our wall right there beside John's bed. So in that journey there of believing and trusting, in Carla's journey, putting that wall on there, that set things in place as we walk through it. Now, I get a call from Charlie one day, and he says this, the Lord says, it's going to look like death. It's going to smell like death. It's going to taste like death, but it's not death. So when we went through that journey and that time frame there, you know, in terms of John, we have leukemia. Then we add a systemic staph infection. Then we have bleeding issues. Then we have lungs filled with blood. Then we get on a ventilator. Then we have tophilitis, which is a bowel infection. Then we have heart issues. Then we have lung issues. Then we have kidney issues and have to go on dialysis. Then we have liver issues. Carla and I looked at each other one day and we said, God, it'd be great just to get around to having just leukemia. Well, then it hit me when they kind of slipped by me there in that diagnosis time. If you make it through the first part. Well, let me just say that over that time, that if started doing this, getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And then one day, Doc came in, and I think Carla was in the parent room. I was sitting in there, and the doc came in, and he looked at me, and he had tears in his eyes. And he says, and now he's got a fungal infection, which in his mind, that meant it. It was it. That word, that's it. So as we're walking these things out, dealing with them, I asked the doc, I said, I'm sure there's a thing called a sickness scale. If there's not, there should be. You know, on a sickness scale of 10, where does John fit? And he said, oh, leukemia plus multiple organ failures, 9.5 at least out of 10. Well, Carla's believing. I apologize again. Wrong belt. You ever hear that story about the guy that went to a silent monastery, joined a silent monastery? I think there's been a few people that have been doing that silent retreat thing. Well, you'd go 5 years in this monastery, silent monastery, and then they'd let you give, say, two words. So they called him in after 5 years and said, you know, Brother Smith, you've been doing a great job, you know, what are your two words? And he said, hard bed. So he goes back, does another 5 years of no words. They call him back in and says, it's been another 5 years. What would you like to say on your two words? And he goes, cold food. And the head of the monastery says, we're going to have to ask you to leave because you've done nothing but complain since you got here. We're during this journey, you know, Carla's got the word there, and there were several challenges along the way that when it looked like death, when it smelled like death, when it tasted like death, do you believe what you see? Or do you believe what he said? And that's always a part of the journey. You know, Paul said it this way, for we walk not by sight, but we walk by faith. And there were some challenges along the way. Are we going to believe what we smell? Are we going to believe what we taste? Are we going to believe what we see? Are we going to believe what God said? Well, Ephesians 6 says this, praying at all times with all kinds of prayers. Let me just tell you, when we are in St. Jude for 35 days in ICU at death's door, you use all of those. You use all of them. I'm praying. I run out of words. There was a prayer walk. Well, that's not a prayer walk, but it was a place down in the bottom of St. Jude building. There's a quarter mile track, and I'd go down there in the middle of the night, and I'd just walk that thing and pray. One night, I'm sitting in John's room. It's like 3 o'clock in the morning. I push all the things away from the bed, and I make a little rat trail around his bed, and it's Jericho time. So I walked around, and I did it again, and I did it again. And on that last one, I did it 7 times, and I went and picked up a pillow. So when I yelled, it wasn't going to disturb ICU, and I just yelled as loud as I could, you know, in terms of that. The nurses at ICU at the desk are going, what's he doing in there? Throwing everything, all these kinds of prayers, I'm throwing it at it. One of the things that we also had is that there was a Sharper Image CD player on the wall. And this was back during these ancient things called CDs. And we got multiple CD, worship CDs, and had worship music playing 24/7. We actually found out that some of the nurses would ask to come take care of John because it was so peaceful in there. Now, I would love to tell you we had all this figured out and we had a strategy. We're just kind of going through there. You know, the Lord's doing this and we're just saying, yes, Lord, let's do that. Throw this at it, throw that at it. Trying to work through this. I have a set here of things, and I'm going to call them cafeteria lessons. Great cafeteria at St. Jude. Love the chicken tenders. Ate like 82 pounds of them while we were there. But we would go down and it'd be families around the table and you'd hear people go, we have CLL. And the treatment is 3 years. And you just, and it was like they had a person sitting at the table with this name of a disease, like it was part of the family. And this thing rose up in me, and I went, no! No, 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 no. It's just like it's part of the family. Somewhere in that journey, you know, John's knocked out, you know, a drug-induced coma. And I'm reading one morning, which was hard to do. You know, and the Lord spoke to me in Psalm 23, and he says, yea, though you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you will fear no evil, for I am with thee. And it was interesting. He rhema'd and highlighted to me the word through. Yea, though you walk through. Bing, 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 through. And John was laying there in the bed, and you saw the picture of it. And I learned years ago that even though somebody's out physically, that their spirits are still active and know what's going on. So I got down on John's chest, and I said, John, this is Dad. I'm speaking to your spirit now. The Lord says we're just passing through here. We're not getting an address. We're not getting an apartment. We're not getting anything. We're just passing through here. So I want you to know we're just passing through. Don't be putting any roots down. Don't want any identity. This is just place. This is a place that we're passing through there. And I would get on his chest and I would speak to his spirit multiple times to let him know what the Lord was saying. The other thing in that cafeteria, well, I found that I resisted this word remission. Right back on, but he stayed off and his oxygen sets, and that would be in the email, we need our oxygen sets to go up to 88, up to 90, and that was part of it, and we began to do that. So as we walked through that time getting off the ventilator, and then they had to teach him to walk again because he'd been laying in a bed for 35 days. But you can see there in that picture in a wheelchair, got a little smile going on there. His younger sister driving him there. Go ahead and put the next one up. Oh! I just jumped ahead. Because, but God. Go ahead, next one. This is John and his wife, Erica. And next picture. And I just wanted to finish it out. That's John's Livingston Parish picture with his camo hat on there. And I didn't know that this was going to happen. But John and Erica, would y'all stand up? John is in charge of security over at Bethany 22 years later. So, to God be the glory. One quick thing that I forgot, but, you know, I still got the microphone, so I'm going to say it. This is part of the journey. One morning during that period, it all kind of runs together. I'm looking out the window of John's room. And God says this, Andy, are you willing for John to die if that's what I want? And he pauses for effect with me, and he said, I sent my son to die. I asked Abraham to sacrifice his son, and now you're piling on. You know, and the Lord and I had this little thing going on when he asked me a question. He goes, I said, well, I know the right answer. And that's just being honest. I got the right. He said, I don't want the right answer. I want the real answer. So I had to go and wrestle that out with the Lord. Am I willing to let John die if that's what God wants? And I finally came to him in tears going, yes, Lord, if that's what you want. I don't like it, but if that's what you want, yes. Later, he told me, he said, Andy, I knew the answer to that question, but you needed to know the answer to that question. Sometimes I may be short, but I'm slow too. So let me wrap it up here. Along the journey, gosh, get in the habit of giving thanks in all things. First thing you want to do when you have a trial or tribulation is give thanks. That sets you in the right place. Walk by faith and not by sight. What was the old song? Whose report do you believe? You know? And so we and it was so clear with Carla when with Charlie's word and with the words up on that on there and on those poster boards. When it smells, looks, likes, and tastes, what are you going to believe? Another thing, too, after it was over, you know, Psalm 30, verse 5 says, weeping may last for the night, but a shout of joy comes in the morning. You know, one of the things I've seen with trials is this too shall pass. That's where that endurance thing comes in. That's where that persevering thing comes in. That's where that hang in there-ness thing comes in. Ecclesiastes 7:8 says, the end of a matter is better than the beginning, and patience is better than pride. After all this was over and things were getting back to normal, oh, another thing I just remembered. We were homeschooling the kids at that point and involved in cell group at Bethany. And when this thing hit, it kind of consumed our lives. And Carla was saying the other day, she said, you know, there were probably 30 days in that time frame that we really didn't know where our kids were or who had them. Why? Because the body of Christ rose up and said, don't worry about them. We got them. And as Carla says, she says, I was completely at peace. Wherever they were, whoever they were with, we're good. And that took a lot of the pressure, you know, off of that part of the journey. And I'll close with this. Charlie asked the Lord, he said, when did Andy and Carla win this battle? And the Lord's answer to him was this, 20 years ago when they began to store up my word in their hearts. So you don't wait till you're in the middle of the eye of the hurricane to go buy batteries or water or food. You're preparing now for when that thing hits, not if that thing hits. you know, for faith to rise up and do what it should. Let me pray. Father, thank you, thank you, thank you. I give you the glory for your story. I thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your faithfulness to us, to each person here. And Lord, I pray when, for each person here, when the tribulations come, that you'd give them the grace to give thanks in all things. To give grace, to give thanks in all things. Lord, I put a hedge of protection around here. Lord, in the midst of it, you said you were going to go with us. Be of good cheer that when there's tribulation, that you have overcome and that we can have peace. And I pray for each person here that you would give them the peace that passes all understanding, that would keep their hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. So, Father, we give you the glory in Jesus' name.